So, you're at peace with the world now.
Well, I'm always hyper, so I'll try to sit still.
But you're opening a festival today.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm always hyper like this every single day. I just happen to be exhausted and hyper all at the same time.
It's a great combination.
Yeah.
So is it easier to open the festival now than it ever was?
No, not really. I mean, you know, because this year is very different because we have been at Lemley Theaters, you know, basically since the beginning in 1998. And this year, being at the Chinese, it's a bigger venue. We're inside of H&H, which is, you know, so it's just a little crazier, you know. And we have, you know, some great people that have been working with us. I mean, we have a great publicist who has really helped, you know, so, but it's always kind of crazy just trying to get the elephant through the door, because I always feel like I'm like at the back end of the elephant, and once we push it through the door, it all seems to work. You know, because...
So when do you feel like it's through the door? Day three, or...?
No, I mean, pretty much after we get off the first shot, if you will, tomorrow, because tomorrow is the main day at 2:45, and so after that, you know, we're sort of... In the groove, you know, because Dance with Films is very, we really have tried to create a community of filmmakers and friendliness in the you know, among the festival. So it's not about you know, a lot of competition between all of those people, and they sort of get the whole purpose of Dance with Films. And so
what is the whole purpose of Dance with Films?
Okay, the whole purpose of Dance with Films. I mean, the festival started in 1998, yeah. And the reason was is because we realized Leslie. My co-partner or partner and I put this festival together because we had a feature film that we wanted to get to the industry, but we initially submitted to like the major fest, about five fest. We are kind of the group of filmmakers today who literally submit to film 50 film festivals all over the place. But we submitted to the top five, you know, we all know the names, Sundance, Toronto, Berlin, yada, yada, yada. Got rejections from all of them. But Dance with Films, oddly enough, wasn't born out of rejection. It was born out, we realized that there was a lot of politics in the film festival scene. You know, we had a film that no one was in, you know, no one had ever heard of. And we realized that was kind of playing against us. So then our thought was, do we want to do, you know, an industry screening, you know, Harmony Gold or something like that, like a lot of people do. But then, you know, sometimes those are good, sometimes those are bad. But we also wanted to connect with a bunch of filmmakers that were sort of in the same place as us. You know, obviously the indie scene had begun before 1998, but 1998 was still kind of, you know, sort of in the beginning stages of it, you know, because it began really in the 90s anyway. But we also wanted to connect with a lot of filmmakers, like I said, that were sort of in the same place, that had a bunch of films that were good but had no one in them, you know. So we decided to put together this film festival called Dances with Films. The original title was called Dance with Films Festival of the Unknowns. And the reason was is because, you know, when we announced that we were going to accept submissions for this film festival, we got a cease and desist letter from Orion Pictures, who own the, you know,
Dance with Wolves.
And said we couldn't use the name Dance with Films, and so anyway, they finally backed down because, you know, there was some press about it in the Hollywood Reporter and other places, and they kind of let it go. But the reason why we had Festival of the Unknowns is because we had Dances with Films, and then we had Festival of the Unknowns. In case anyone showed up, like, you know, lawyers from Orion or whatever, we were just going to spray paint Dance with Films out, and then today we would actually just have a film festival called Festival of the Unknowns as opposed to Dance with Films. So it began in 1998, and you know, and the whole point of it was, and our credo is always kind of like no politics, no stars, no shit.
You can say shit all you like.
Oh, I can. Okay.
Yes.
I'm not really a person that swears a lot, but anyway, it's kind of funny that we had that credo because the purpose of it was to have films in competition that were, you know, had unknown actors, writers, directors, producers. In other words, they couldn't be connected in any way in terms of financing, in terms of distribution possibilities, and we were really looking for the best films on, but having them on a level playing field. So you didn't get into the festival because you had, you know, X celebrity in it. Mm-hmm. By the way, Dance with Films is not anti-celebrity at all. The whole purpose of it is just to simply support, you know, indie filmmakers and give them a break and let them compete against, you know, something that is equal. You know, right. You're competing with talent, not competing with who you know and all of that sort of thing. You know, so we had the first year of the festival and it was great. It was at Lemley's in Santa Monica. And then the reason why we did it the second year was because a lot of filmmakers said, you got to do this again. But the other reason was is because Leslie and I have a tendency to do these kind of cool little projects, but we do them once, then we go do something else. As you can tell, I'm kind of, you know, hyper anyway. But so we decided we were going to do it a second year just because we wanted to prove to ourselves we could do it again. But then the second year, the reason why we continued it after that is because we had a film called Kusahakwan out of Alaska. And it was a filmmaker by the name of Sean Morris, and he could not get his film into any festival anywhere. And it was the first film shot in Alaska, made by an Alaskan. Anyway, it screened at the festival, had its world premiere there, and then right after that, it became a permanent installation at the Smithsonian. So we realized that what we're doing actually has some value. And also and also back to Dance with Films, we wanted to have a film festival that we really felt like film festivals should be about, discovering films, as opposed to, you know, opening films that would literally open, you know, 2 weeks later at the multiplex down the street.
Right.
So
how do people dive into Dance with Films? Is the idea that you just show up and go to the movies and not know what you're getting yourself into, not really be judgmental in that regard, just spend the afternoon?
Yeah, I think so. You know, because I mean, Dance with Films, for one thing, is got kind of it has kind of a following. It has a really good rep in terms of the indie scene is concerned, you know, because we really try to maintain integrity with everything that we do. And we really try to have this no politics, no thing, which makes this kind of community effort in terms of people not feeling like they have to fight or, you know, with you know, amongst each other. Mm-hmm. And all the filmmakers really come together each year and support each other. But when people come to the festival, yeah, they don't necessarily know what they're looking, you know, to get. But then again, you can go to, you know, the multiplex down the street, and right. even though you have X celebrity in it or X great director, you don't necessarily know right. what you're going to get. I mean, you know.
You're being sold something very specifically, and the whole you're being targeted and.
Sure, but we don't really sell. I mean, because the festival, while there's a lot of public that comes to it, I mean, our real focal point is industry. You know, it's to help these filmmakers, you know, get seen by industry people that can hopefully, you know, take them to the next level, either with that film through distribution, yada yada yada, or future projects.
So, have your rules been bent at all over the years?
No, because like I said, we do have some names that play in the festival, right. but they're out of competition. Nearly always, they're spotlight screenings of alumni films. I mean, for instance, like we have a film that opens the festival tonight called Jeremy Fink and the Meaning of Life, and that is by a filmmaker by Tamar Halpern, and she won the 2005 Grand Jury Award for a film called Shelf Life. But this year, she has this cool feel-good film called Jeremy Fink and the Meaning of Life, and it has Mira Savino in it, Joe Pantalone, and you know, and so yeah, those are obviously names. You know, Academy Award winner. An Emmy Award winner, but no, we really don't bend the rules. I mean, you know, there is sometimes there's a question of it's a little bit subjective when we say unknown,
right?
You know, because we do have it. You know, there are films that have, you know, potentially working actors, but they are not actors that generally. And I hope it changes for them, or maybe it is changed for them, and maybe I have this wrong. But generally speaking, these aren't films that you're going to get names that you're going to raise financing dollars right. for, and you're not going to get distribution based on those names. Whereas you have someone like Mira Savino, you know, you're going to, you know, have those doors open for you.
So you don't go, you know, Mira Savino's career is not going so well right now. She's no longer.
Oh no! I mean, because
we can
like
let her
I said,
in now.
Yeah, no. I mean, she's.
Once you're a celebrity, you're a celebrity.
Yeah, I mean, you know, wouldn't we all want to be a celebrity? I mean, you know, I mean, everyone wants to be a celebrity. I mean, and that's the funny thing, you know, when I wanted to tell you a funny story, because like in the very beginning of the festival back in 1998, and when we said we wanted to create this film festival about unknowns, and we talked to a bunch of industry people that we knew, and one of the, and I forgot what the name was, because Leslie, my partner, who would be great if she was here, she's terrific with names, I'm just terrific with just being hyper, but she, we talked to this one person, and they said, so you're going to do a film festival about unknowns, are you going to scream porn? Because at that time they were thinking, oh, well, if you have a film with no one in it, it must be porn.
Right.
You know, I mean, that was kind of the mentality. And of course, that's an exaggeration.
You had porn submitted?
No. We've had a lot of dance films because sometimes, you know, I mean, a lot of people think that we're about dance because it's called Dances with Films, even though Sundance isn't about dancing suns or, all these other things. No, but we've never had porn submitted to the festival. We've had a kind of a cool documentary about porn.
Well, it's kind of interesting, actually, because every once in a while you have these waves where the porn business thinks they're making art again, or they invest in a movie, and then it's, you know, maybe they think they try to... I grew up in the era, I went to high college in the era when they were thought they were crossing over because of Caligula and stuff like that. It didn't really happen.
Yeah.
Because they weren't very good. Sex was okay. Movies weren't so good.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's true. The indie scene, too.
So how has the business of being in the film festival business changed for you over the last decades?
Well, I don't know. I mean, yeah, because Leslie and I... it's not really a business to us. It's kind of a labor of love, you know, and it really has, you know, because any monies that are generated by the festival are just basically sunk back into the festival. And one of the reasons why we've survived 15 years is because we're not stupid. You know, we try to guess what, you know, the income and losses will be. So we guess all of this.
And you both have enormous trust funds.
Oh, no.
No. Well, how do you survive? I mean, you must invest enormous amounts of your time.
Oh, we do that. Every year. I mean, you know, it wouldn't survive if we didn't spend a lot of time doing it because we can't pay a lot of people to do a lot of these things, which is why, you know, it's just crazy even like today, because right now, even as we're talking and having and again, I appreciate, you know, having this great conversation with you. But I mean, there's so many other things that are going into my head, like, you know, oh, did I pick up the tape for the red carpet? I mean, you know, like the stupid things.
So for you, at the end of the festival, you know, a week later, 2 weeks later, you look at the numbers, even is a happy number.
Yeah, even as a happy, yeah,
zeros absolutely. Out. You're,
yeah,
you're like, okay.
I mean, we've always done that. I mean, we've always survived. We've always, we've never lost anything. Sorry, I didn't mean that. Yeah, so we've always been successful in that regard, and the crowds have grown each and every year. I mean, you know, we according to Lemley, you know, theaters, you know, we were one of their highest grossing film festivals, you know, and of course, if you know Lemley Theaters, maybe you're not from Los Angeles, but if you know Lemley Theaters, they're the number one art house in Los Angeles, and so they have a lot of film festivals that have come through there. I mean, there's I don't know how many film festivals are in this city. There's 150. I don't know. You know.
So what inspired the move?
Lemley, because we've always been Lemley Sunset, which is kind of like their, you know, main theater. And unfortunately, they lost that theater just this last year. And it's now changing into Sundance Cinema, you know, which is cool. But, you know, Lemley is also has continually expanded. They have a beautiful new theater in NoHo.
Right.
But we wanted to stay kind of centrally located because, again, you know, Dance with Films is really all about industry. So we didn't want to be completely in the West Side. We didn't want to be, you know, in the Valley, even though, you know, all industry is everywhere. Right. We wanted to be some sort of central. And then when we went to the Chinese Theater, I mean, they really opened their arms to us.
Are they still operated by man at this point?
No, they're not. I think that they were bought, and see, this is where Leslie would know, but it was bought about 6 months ago. Yeah. And the new management is terrific. I mean... they really are dynamite.
Because it does seem to be one of the new festival. AFI has gone there, and
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
ArcLight seems to be gotten out of the festival business, and This group seems to have gotten into it.
Well, I mean, it takes it takes special management skills on behalf of theaters to really deal with film festivals. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are a lot of film festivals that are way smaller than Dance with Films in terms of numbers, in terms of all of that sort of thing. I mean, there are film festivals that literally have screenings and 20 people in the audience. Mm-hmm. I mean, we, on the other hand, have a lot of screenings that sell out, and we have people wrapped around the corner and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. But because we have certain numbers that come, you know, that takes a lot of management skill and a lot of patience from theaters such as the Chinese theater. I mean, they sort of have to understand that, get it, and appreciate, you know, what we're doing, and they seem to really do that.
So you take over all six screens, or
oh no, we're just at one screening.
Only one screening.
Yeah, and we've always done one screening every single one venue every single year, because it's there are many things that are different about Dance with Films than other film festivals. We could have two screenings going at once, three screenings going at once. We could have panels going against it. We could have various parties, right, or whatever, but we never do. We never have competition. So whatever is, because with Dance with Films, it's all about the films. It's not about anything else. So if something is screening, there's nothing else happening at the festival. I mean, we may have a happy hour going, you know, in the filmmaker's lounge, and there are other activities like that, but there's no event happening at that same time. And we've always done that every single year, even though it's kind of problematic in terms of scheduling and everything else. But
so are you filmmakers lounging at the Chinette, or are you doing it across the Roosevelt, or?
Well, we have the VIP lounge, which is in the Chinese Sixth Theater. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've ever been there, but they have it.
Nice.
Just about. Oh, just the yeah, just all that. Well, it's so were you at the Universals?
Anyway, yes, I was.
Yeah.
Snow White and the Huntsman is not a Dances with Film film. Pretty sure it doesn't qualify.
That is probably true. Anyway, we have that VIP lounge, you know, which is rings the main lobby of the theater. We're also over at the Renaissance because another cool thing that we have been doing. This is the sixth year. It's called the 2-Minute Two Step Short Film Challenge, mm-hmm. And Canon is a huge partner in this and helps us make it happen. But essentially, what the 2-Minute Two Step Short Film Challenge is we give filmmakers 4 hours to shoot and edit a 2-minute film. And then we screen that film in front of competition films the very next night. So, you know, it gives an opportunity for filmmakers to become acquainted with Canon cameras, although, you know, Canon, you know, a lot of filmmakers obviously are very familiar with Canon cameras, but the newest technologies. I mean, because this year we're shooting with, like, the C300, which is a, you know.
So you're shooting video, you're not shooting the 5D or the 7D or anything?
Well, we have, we've been shooting with the 5D for the last 2 years, and we have a lot of 5Ds running around, but, you know, but there's a new wave, coming out with, you know, Canon's technology, so.
So how much has it changed because everything has changed? I mean, it's in the last 10 years, as you're pointing out, technology has changed dramatically, the independent scene has changed dramatically, distribution has changed dramatically, the whole thing is upside down. Does that change your world much?
Well, I mean, in terms of just screenings, I mean, it's changed considerably. I mean, because in the very first year, we kind of had an attitude against anything that wasn't shot on film. Now, very few. I mean, we have a few films in the festival this year that, you know, were shot on film, but by and large,
can
everything
they even
is
screen on film at the.
Yeah, we have screenings. Yeah, on film. You know, you know. Luckily, Chinese theater. You know, because it's an industry.
Right.
You know, it's in a. Because if we were in Kansas or something, you know, they wouldn't even have a 35 projector, or
right,
they won't in the next several years, definitely.
I don't know that the Chinette will in the next several years either.
You know, but a lot of but they have a lot of industry screening, so until everything completely goes to DCP,
right,
you know, or all digital. But you asked how it changed. It's changed a lot, you know, through the years. Like I said, in the very first year, we were screening 35 and 16. Uh-huh. And the only video that we screened was kind of our little trailer at the opening and said, hey, we're Dance with Films. But everything else was, you know, film. But then that obviously progressed, you know, because that was during DV. DV was coming out. And, mm-hmm. and again, we had this kind of like, DV, this is, you know, looks like. Anyway, but this year we are screening like 7 or 8 different formats, and a lot of film festivals can't do that.
Right.
We screen everything from, you know, low end. I don't mean low end, but I mean lower formats like right, a Beta SP, mm-hmm. Up to DCP. But by and large, and we're also even doing MP4 QuickTime.
So you're actually screening stuff in MP4 QuickTime and
yeah,
Beta?
Yeah.
Wow.
With this.
On the big screen.
On the big screen, and it looks phenomenal. Yeah, I mean it because it's all digital, and right. Plus we have an amazing technical person, Kareem Duran, who's unbelievable, and everyone that's in the film festival world in Los Angeles knows Kareem. I mean, you know, he is the main person over at the LA Film Festival. Mm-hmm. He's with AFI. He's with a lot of people, and I'll just butcher his credits if I go on, but he's unbelievable, and yeah, so.
So is what is submitted to you, not just the formats, changed over this period of time? In a significant way?
Yeah, I mean, but not really. I mean, it has, but it's just gone with technology. I mean, you know, we had a lot of DV in the beginning years, right. And then it switched to, you know, the HD that was kind of weird, and everyone, like, looked at it, and it was so flat,
right.
You know, that we thought, this medium's never going to work, you know? You know, but now HD, you know, is...
But the context of the films hasn't changed that much to you.
No, not at all.
How many submissions do you guys get?
About 1,200. I think there were 1,300 something this year. These in the last several years, I haven't been working, you know, in the programming area. Uh-huh. That's mainly been Leslie, and because there's a group that begins basically in January. Mm-hmm. As submissions come in. But yeah, we receive a number of a ton of submissions. You know, but and they're all screened. We're not a film festival that just sort of like, you know, picks and chooses, oh, that's a pretty cover,
right,
and pops it in. We literally look at everything, and filmmakers know that we look at everything, because if they get a rejection letter, and we even hesitate to call them rejection letters, we call them pass letters, because in our opinion, no opinion on the face of the earth is going to make or break, you know, your film as a filmmaker. Not our opinion, not Sundance, no one's opinion. You know, it's all completely subjective. So we don't like to call them rejection letters, call them pass letters, but inside those letters we actually give them some positive comments of what we thought about the film. So they'll know that we actually do care, because we actually do. I mean, it takes an enormous amount of time just to do all of those elements. So
how many films are you paring down to from 1,200?
This year we are going to have about just under 90. Yeah, I mean, the last several years we've been in between 90 and 100. But again, a lot of the scheduling has to do with, do we have a lot of long shorts? Because we don't discount long shorts. You know, there are film festivals that will, you know, you can only do 7 minutes or lower, right, or 10 minutes or shorter. You know, if a film really grabs us that's 32 minutes, it's in, you know.
So 8%, an 8% success rate in getting in is actually pretty encouraging to people,
yeah.
I would think.
Yeah, I mean, you're good at math. it's a pretty good rate, you know, but those are not everything that's in the film festival. The 87 films that are in this year, they're not all competition. But you know, and there's reasons.
So how do you distinguish competition from non-competition?
Well, in terms of just the films, I mean, some of them are spotlight, you know, alumni spotlights.
Right.
We don't want to, you know, either they don't qualify for, you know, competition any longer,
right,
because they might have a name in it or whatever. You know, other films that are in Fusion, sometimes they've been seen at many different places. And Denso Films really looks to, you know, have world premieres. And a lot of filmmakers, I think, on the film festival circuit don't get why, you know, certain film festivals are all, you know, about world premieres. They just think it's a vanity issue. It's not a vanity issue. We want world premieres because our whole purpose is industry. You know, if we screen a bunch of films that have been seen all over the place,
right,
then it's you know, so we really are looking for the films, the discoveries.
Well, for some people it is vanity or an angle or a
position. Yeah, I mean, you know, for some
you guys,
festivals,
clearly not.
No, it's not.
I mean, I always thought that a great festival would be films that actually didn't get sold at other festivals, but that were worthwhile, that actually you put them in front of an audience in Los Angeles. So, you know, the 10 distributors could see them with an audience and see how they play again and, you know, have a shot at resurrection.
I mean, there have been
certain film festival.
Well, yeah, but there was the Reject Film Festival, you know, several years ago that ran for, and I thought, you know, that was a kind of a cool concept. I don't think they're still around anymore. But
rejected.
They were rejected. No, I don't know them, but I'm sure it was probably a cool fun festival. But
so after 15 years, you must feel like a survivor.
Yeah, just feel really old. You know, because after...
I've seen a lot of festivals come and go, though, in that time.
Oh, no kidding. And big festivals. I mean, there are big festivals with huge sponsor, you know, highly funded that, you know, are gone after 6 years or whatever. And I won't name names, but, you know. But being around for 15 years, not only do we feel old, we are old. You know, because 15 years, it's sort of like, you know, a friend of mine used to joke, he was a magician and traveled all over around the world, and he would always talk about the fact that he'd been married for, you know, 20 years, and he said, you know, in Los Angeles, that's a felony. You know, because things just don't last. But, you know, Dance with Films lasts mainly because there's, I mean, we have alumni of the festival that have been involved in the festival since the beginning. You know, that, you know, like Robert Millette, he's a great supporter, and he's an associate director with the festival. He had a film in 2000. You know, that actually was an award winner, but he has been part of Dance with Films ever since then. He writes our blog. He's great. But we have a number of people that are like that, and that's how one of the reasons why Dance with Films is able to survive all this time. So
are you raising young pups to come up behind you and? You know.
No, not really. But that might be a good idea. But, you know, to tell you the truth, I'm not really, you know, it would be on Leslie's side if she did that, because I'm so, I'm kind of an, you know, very particular in terms it's very difficult for me to, like, work with a bunch of people. I'm much more of the person that, like, needs everyone to run away, and I, and then I, hey. You know, so I'm not a very, you know, I'm not a good mentor in that sense. The way that I feel like I mentor is just helping, you know, having Dance with Films to support other filmmakers. But personally, for the festival, no, we're not raising young pups. We don't feel like we're that old. I mean, it's not like we're 65 or anything, you know, that we're heading for retirement. But
it is possible to get tired of something after 15 years, 20 years. No?
Really? Yeah, I mean, of course it is. Yeah, I mean, because there's a lot of pedantic stuff, you know, because with, like I said, with the small group of people that put this together every year, I mean, I'm taking out the trash and I'm doing, you know, an interview with you. I mean, mm-hmm. Two totally different ends of the spectrum.
I have trash too, if you want to take it out.
Do you? I, you know.
My wife would be very happy with
I'm
me.
Sure she would. I'm sure she
just
would.
Just lie and say it was my doing. So do you, I mean, but it, so you're, you've kind of like, this feels like you've found your thing.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, we already felt like we found our thing in the very beginning, you know, because to us, film festivals should be about discovery. And if it's just about marketing, it's just, to me, that isn't what a film festival is about. No, nothing against film festivals that are all about that, but, you know, to me, that's not what a film festival should be.
But it doesn't sound like you have a lot of time to make movies or to...
Well, you know, we have a lot of, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, that has been a very difficult thing. It's a trade-off. You know, we sacrifice a lot of time, obviously, to do this. You know, I mean, literally, you know, we work 4 in the morning and get up at 8, 4 in the morning, and we do this for weeks leading up to the festival, not to mention all the screening time, you know, just sitting watching film after film after film, you know, and some of them are hard to watch, as you can imagine.
Yes, I can. I programmed a festival one year. I ran a festival one year, and it was quite an adventure.
Yeah, that's a very political way of putting it.
When you're in film number 80 for, you know, the 2-day weekend, you're kind of like, okay, checking out. So at the end of the festival, what will it be like for you? Do you lay down for a week, or do you?
Yeah, I mean, personally, I just kind of like crash for 24 hours, and then I can't sit around. I mean, I barely slept in the last 3 weeks, as you can probably tell, but I'm still can barely just sit in this chair. I just go. So, yeah, but I mean, it is exhausting. You know, it's a race.
So will you start worrying about next year's festival immediately, or will you start worrying about it in November? Or?
Oh, no. No, we don't worry about the film festival until at the end of the year. You know, because people submit to the festival, and it starts going, whether we say we're accepting submissions or not, they'll take the last year's submission, and they just start submitting. You know, so it's not like we have to rev up in that sense. In fact, if we did nothing, you know, a lot of it would just happen, you know, a lot of films we would be sitting in our office, you know, come next March. And so then I guess we got to do that again.
So what will you be doing in August?
I don't know. You know, if you really want to know, I got to take care of my mom. So no, I'm kidding. I mean, I don't have time. I mean, you know, I have so little time. I have an elderly mom that I haven't seen in such a long time. Got to go see her, you know, but And Leslie wants to go to Italy, and, you know, and yeah, I mean, so we'll probably relax.
So you're not like chasing on to other festivals or?
Oh no, I mean, you want to hear something? It's truly ironic. I mean, there's a couple of, I think maybe two film festivals I've ever been to. Mm-hmm. I've never been to another film festival. Huh. Leslie, on the other hand, my partner, is totally the opposite of me. She's been everywhere. She knows everyone, and you know, but. Yeah, I'm not a person that has gone to a lot, mainly because I watch so many indie films.
Right. And how much of the festival that you have do you watch? Well, do you watch any of it?
During the festival?
During the festival, yeah.
A lot of it, because I do a lot of the Q&As, and so I want to make sure, you know, because we're also not a film festival that like hands the or leaves a mic at the bottom of the stage. We actually, you know, bring the filmmakers down, and we try to ask questions that are better than like, so how much was the budget? You know,
somebody in the audience will ask that question.
Every time. But, you know, we really try to dig into what they were trying to do with their film and try to capture, you know, some of those elements and bring those up in Q&A. So, yeah, I watch a lot of stuff at the festival, mainly just to say, okay, these are the things that I was thinking of and blah, blah, blah. You know.
And do you get a sense outside of your own head of what you've done for other people, what you've contributed to the community?
I mean, you know, there are a lot of people that have been very thankful. I mean, we, you know, of the festival over the years, you know, there have been, but I don't really think about that. I mean, cause that was sort of the thought to begin with, was to, you know, to create, you know, something that the people could benefit from, but I don't really think about it. I hope that people get, you know, great value in it because, you know, that is really the only reason why we do it. Because it's not, you know, in other words, we don't choose a particular film because we think it's going to sell out. It's, mm-hmm. We choose a particular film because we believe in the filmmaker. And sometimes that translates into sellout crowds. Sometimes it doesn't, but that's okay. You know, I mean, seriously, because, I mean, we've had films, you know, like I said, by and large, we have great attendance. But every now and then you'll have like this gem. You know, I mean, we had a film a couple of years ago, and I won't identify even the country from because it'll identify the film. But it was such a wonderful film, and I think we had like, you know, 40 people in the house. But mm-hmm. It was this wonderful international. It was gold. You know, but that's okay. Again, you know, and it has found success. You know, because there's a lot of films that go directly into other film festivals. Right. You know, get picked up, if you will. You know, we're not a film festival that ever invites films, mainly because that goes against the whole politics thing. You know, because we don't give away time slots. You know, to before people. Are actually submitting and taking mm-hmm. the time to submit, so that's unfair, you know. So we really try to be as fair as we possibly can in this weird city of Los Angeles.
And that film was The Artist.
Yeah. And look where it went. Yeah, and we discovered it. No, it wasn't The Artist. In fact, I can't even remember the title of the film. I just remember the country. But it was a great film, and he's anyway.
He's moved on.
Yeah, I mean, moved on in a good way.
Yes.
Not moved on in like, oh, I'm over filmmaking, you know. No. I mean, you know, because there are a lot of people out there that make a film. And then they realize, my gosh, this was hard. I mean, hard. I mean, they don't realize that, oh, they're going to be in debt for the next 10 years as they try to, like, recoup whatever. And then they couldn't get it sold. They couldn't, or if they got it sold, they literally got it sold, you know, for nothing to where they can't mm-hmm. pay anyone. You know, because a lot of these are, you know, ultra, ultra low budgets where everyone's working for free and they're working on deferred pay, which many times never comes. Mm-hmm. But you work on the belief. You work on you have to be in this business not to make money, you know. Everyone wants to do that, but if you're doing it to make money, I mean, you really should try to do something else because there are many other, I mean, you know, making money is kind of the cream, you know, that you actually get paid to do something you love to do because I don't know what the statistics are, but isn't it like 90 some odd percent of people in the country, you know, don't like their jobs, you know, so actually, I mean, it's a pretty good rate if you can do it. So, and I kind of rambled there, but... I'm not sure what that point was because it was a cool point, and you're just gonna leave me hanging. You're just gonna leave me hanging. But anyway, but if you wait long enough, because the festival, what I was saying is that a lot of filmmakers make one film and then they realize how difficult it is and then they sort of give up. We are trying to encourage people not to give up. You know, you may have some tough road and you may have some bumps and you may have people that hate your film. You know, in fact, everyone may hate it. And yeah, there may be the possibility, maybe even a strong possibility, you shouldn't be doing this. But there are a number of filmmakers that are success today that made films that weren't very good in the beginning. You know, mm-hmm. because it's like an artist, you know, going to a canvas. I mean, it takes a lot of canvases, you know, to be a master at certain things, or to be a master, as a painter. And it's the same with film. But the problem is that film is a little bit more expensive, you know, than a $200 canvas and you know, $800 worth of paint. So.
Great.
I thought that was a good tap.
It was.